Meanwhile, at least one person died and over 26,000 individuals were affected by Tropical Storm Dodong. The National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council adds over 1,800 individuals were displaced due to flooding and landslides caused by the storm. And meanwhile, no major damage to infrastructure and agriculture has been reported yet. Dodong left the Philippine area of responsibility Saturday, but the southwest monsoon continues to drench most parts of the country. Let's get an update on the weather now with Pag-asa forecaster Lori De La Cruz. Good morning, Lori. How's the weather looking now? Is it a little better?
Yes, good morning, and to all our viewers and listeners. At 3 a.m. today, a low-pressure area or the low-pressure area was estimated at 810 kilometers east of northeastern Mindanao. And because of this, cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms will be experienced over Caraca and Davao region due to trough of low-pressure area. While for southwest monsoon, it's still affecting Luzon and Visayas, and it's causing cloudiness over Zambales and Bataan, having rain showers and thunderstorms as well. For Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we have generally improved weather for today, so we're just expecting isolated rain showers or isolated thunderstorms. By the way, gale warning is raised over areas, some areas over the northern seaboard of Northern Luzon, particularly the areas of Ilocos Norte, Ilocos Sur, La Union, Pangasinan, Zambales, Bataan, the western coast of Batangas, Occidental Mindoro, including Lubang Islands and Palawan, including Calamian, Cagayan, Silio, Cuyo, and Calayaan Islands. Fishing boats and other small sea crafts are advised not to venture out into the sea, while larger sea vessels are alerted against the big waves. That's the latest from Pag-asa. This is Lori De La Cruz.
All right, thanks for that update, Lori. Over in South Korea, the death toll from the massive flooding there is now at 40. Nine others remain missing, while 34 people were hurt. Days of heavy rains triggered flooding and landslides across South Korea. 12 of the casualties were bodies recovered from a flooded underpass. South Korean President Yoon Suk-yeol vows to completely overhaul the country's approach to extreme weather, which he says may become the new normal. Over in Greece, wildfires near Athens have forced thousands of residents to flee their homes. The blaze broke out in the village of Poubaras, located just southeast of the Greek capital. At least five houses were severely damaged by the fire. It also tore through the seaside area of Lagunisi, a popular summer resort. And the Greek Meteorological Service warns of a high risk of fire in the country this week. This comes as Europe grapples with a searing heat wave. More news overseas. Russian President Vladimir Putin says Moscow is preparing its response to an attack on the Crimean bridge. Putin called the attack a cruel and senseless act, claiming the bridge has not been used for months to supply Russian forces fighting in Ukraine. Russia also says the attack left two people dead and one person injured. Ukraine did not officially claim responsibility. But Russia's state media said Ukraine used unmanned drones for the offensive. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky calls on Turkey and the United Nations to continue the Black Sea grain shipment deal. Zelensky insists Russia has no right to determine who has enough food to eat, and the grain initiative could operate without Moscow's participation. Russia halted participation in the deal Monday, which lets Ukraine export grain through the Black Sea, spreading fear in poorer countries that price increases will put food out of reach. The UN also condemning Russia's move.
The Black Sea Initiative enabled the safe export of some 33 million metric tons of foodstuffs from three Ukrainian ports, including more than 750,000 metric tons of wheat transported by WFP, helping to relieve hunger in Afghanistan, the Horn of Africa, and Yemen. The initiative helped bring down global food prices. The Memorandum of Understanding on Russian Food and Fertilizer Exports also delivered concrete results over the past year. As the Secretary General stated this morning, the decision of the Russian Federation to terminate the Black Sea Initiative will strike a blow to people in need everywhere.
The U.S. also hitting Russia's termination of the Black Sea grain deal. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken says Russia's decision was unreasonable. He adds the U.S. will be looking for other ways to help get Ukrainian produce on the world market.
So the result of Russia's action today, weaponizing food, using it as a tool, as a weapon in its war against Ukraine, will be to make food harder to come by in places that desperately need it and have prices rise. We're already seeing the market react to this as prices are going up. The bottom line is it's unconscionable. Should not happen. This should be restored as quickly as possible. And I hope that every country is watching this very closely. They will see that Russia is responsible for denying food to people who are desperately needed around the world.
And before we go, let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, PJ Manoto.
Good morning, Nikki. Here are the top stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community here in North America.
We begin with severe weather news. Nearly a quarter of the U.S. population have fallen under extreme heat advisories, partly due to a heat dome that has settled over western states. Temperatures in Death Valley, which runs along part of Central California's border with Nevada, reached 128 degrees Fahrenheit on Sunday, according to the National Weather Service. In Las Vegas, temperatures reached 115 degrees Fahrenheit early Sunday afternoon, approaching the desert city's all-time high of 117 degrees. Philam residents there are doing what they can to stay cool. The National Weather Service warns the heat is the leading weather-related killer in the U.S. Experts advise affected residents to avoid time outdoors. Meanwhile, hundreds braved the Southern California heat wave and flocked to Don Nabe Park in Cerritos, California, for the National Federation of the Philippine American Associations, or NAFA, second annual Philippine American Friendship Day celebration.
Let's continue to strengthen our community, celebrate our rich heritage, and build bridges for the generations to come.
While local performers and acts such as Nevera, DJ Rocky Rock, and Junior News System entertained the crowd, there were also booths that featured Filipino products and services. Two Philam City Council members in Cerritos, Frank Aurelio Yokoyama and Linda Johnson, say continued support from the community as well as elected officials ensures that this year's tradition will be carried on for years to come.
Cerritos has the robust Filipino community in our region. Here in Southeast Los Angeles County, with our friends from Orange County, this is where the Filipinos have an opportunity to come together, party together, eat together.
We had actually 65 booths, 5 food vendors, and we had 2 food trucks, which is double from last year.
And in sports, after winning the U.S. Women's Open last week, Allison Corpus was back at it on the links this past weekend. Corpus finished second in the LPGA Dana Open at Highland Meadows in Ohio. The 25-year-old Phil-Am from Hawaii shot a total of 18 under par during the 4-day tournament, just 3 strokes behind Lynn Grant of Sweden. 2 other Filipinos also took part in the tournament, with Dotty Ardina finishing tied for 26 and 6 under par, and Bianca Pagdanganan's 3 under par, which was good enough for 41st place.
And those are the stories making the rounds here amongst the Filipino community in North America. You can catch more of our stories on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/tfcnews, and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to Nikki for the rundown.